please forgive me, I don't speak Chinese. Sorry, Mandarin or Cantonese, I don't. But it will be a very interesting thing for me to learn. I am honored to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me to your beautiful country. It's the first time for me to come to China, but it's not the first time I've interacted with Chinese, because I sit in a city which is a logistical hub, which attracts a lot of people from different parts of the world, be it from east and west. And for me, this is the first time to come to China. It is a stepping point. I hope I will be lucky enough to come back to your country several times. Now, what brings me to this specific event and conference was something that is important to me. And the reason I bring this to your attention, because it's also important to you, as I'm starting to find out. The first thing for me is the issue of trade, commerce. And the second thing is also something very important to you, and it's also important to me, and that is the issue of philosophy. The conference here is talking about culture. The conference is talking about civilization. And how much more important is civilization and culture if it's not based on a philosophy? Two gentlemen who are the epitome of Chinese culture and civilization, represented by 78th and 79th generation, which is impressive. As a family business, I can tell you, me passing the third or fourth generation is impressive, but to hit 78th or 79th generations is fantastic. But the thing I want to talk to you most about are the similarities that exist between your culture and my culture, and where I come from. And I'm not representing just the UAE. I will be representing, in this talk, the Arab culture. In NIQ, you have a very diversified Chinese culture from different parts of China. We also have different parts of the Arab culture, from west, all the way to Morocco, to east, all the way to Oman, and north, Syria and Iraq, down south to Yemen. But we would be considered, for most people, an Arabic culture. And the similarities that exist between ourselves and yourselves goes back for centuries. Because in like yourself, your whole nation is built on certain understandings, and certain ways of getting things done. So is ours. And the one thing, actually there are two things that are very familiar and very similar between the Chinese culture as a whole and the Arabic culture as a whole. Unfortunately, I must say, both of us have lost one part of it, but I see it's reviving again. But the second part has never left us. The one that we have started with and have gradually lost, both, I will say, the Chinese and also the Arab, is the understanding of philosophy. Understanding the mentality that goes into thought process and how to understand and interact with people. Because on this basis is how you grow. The other thing that we did not lose, I know the Chinese have never lost, and I know we haven't lost, is the ability to do trade, commerce. It's in our blood. Inasmuch as it's in the Chinese blood to want to do commerce and trade, it is within the Arabic blood also to want to do commerce and trade. This is why, if you look at the ones who controlled the Silk Route historically, it starts off in China and ends within the control of the Arab world. The new Silk Route that's happening right now is also starting, I would argue, from Dubai to Shanghai. That's my argument. People would have different arguments, but I still think that it's starting to happen over here. The other things that are important in culture, in civilization, is interaction between one another. How do we interact with one another? And again, there are a lot of similarities that exist between the Chinese and the Arab culture. For example, and by the way, if I am wrong, please correct me, because I'm also a student. I love to learn. The one thing I see is important within the Chinese culture, and I see also in the Arabic culture, is the importance of respect. It's the importance of age. It's the importance of manner. How do I interact with you? What deference do I give you? If you are older than me, if you are in a higher position than I am, how do I interact with you? And you can see that this thing is being repeated, whether it is in here in China or back in my country. Understanding these aspects becomes important because it is very easy to find reasons to fight. And if you think the other party doesn't perform or do or act in a way that you are comfortable with or feel similar to, they will feel you the enemy. And the idea is that more similarities can exist between ourselves as people, the less likely we think of the other side as the enemy. And in this world, looking at how globalization is starting to affect not just trade and commerce, but every aspect of it, the more friends we have, the better it is for all of us. And that's why I'm hoping to be an ambassador to help promote and create more understanding about what happens in my part of the world and bring it as a messenger to you. And hopefully take from this part and take it to my part of the world. Again, I'm very fortunate living in Dubai. I've seen a lot of Chinese companies come and set up. But it's very rare to come across Chinese individuals setting up in our region. And I'm hoping to promote that as well, because one of the most important aspects of trade is helping create comfort between different peoples. We need this today more than ever. Understanding these aspects of life help create what we want to have, not just for ourselves, which is important, but also for our children and our children's children. This world is going to become smaller and smaller and smaller, but sadly, it's going to become more isolated. If we're sitting in a room like this, I can sit and talk to my neighbor. But today, we wake up in an apartment. We go into an elevator. We get into a car. We get into the office. There is no communication. There's no talking to one another. It's very strange to talk to one another. So now, having conferences like this, events like this, not only allows us to sit and talk from human to human, but also to bring my culture and my understanding to you, and also to learn from your culture and your understanding for me to see. I read something which I had never known about, which was perhaps one of the best things I have read ever. And if you'll allow me, I will say it in English. I'm sorry, I cannot speak it in Cantonese. But I will say it in English because it struck me something I hope everyone will learn. Could someone translate this into Mandarin? Because I think a lot of people here might not remember this. It is, learning without thought is labor lost. Thought without learning is perilous. This is important. This is not just important here in China. This is important in the world to understand. We need to understand. I just don't work. I need to understand what I'm working for. Universities, unfortunately, give out degrees for being excellent at doing something. But most people don't go to universities to learn. If you look at the philosophers, if you look at the students of the philosophers, they did not go to learn from the professor or from the philosopher to get a job. They learned because they wanted an education. They learned because it was important for them to expand their minds, to see the world from a different perspective. Unfortunately, most, if not all, universities have lost this perspective. They now will teach the student how to become a good, I don't know, CEO, clerk, something. But they're not teaching the student to open their mind. How important is this type of event for us all? Because here's a chance for us not only to come and sit and listen to conferences and listen to people talk, but also to go back and see who are the philosophers taught that are being taught here. What do they mean? What do they teach? And how can I learn from them? The thing, and I will end on this, but the most important thing that I have learned, I'm 48 years old. I'm young for some, I'm old for some. My 6-year-old daughter tells me I'm very old. But for me, the most important thing that we have lost for a lot of people is the enjoyment of reading books. And I say that because in a book, I would never, because of my age, because of my time, I will never have had the opportunity to meet a great philosopher like Confucius. I wouldn't. But by reading what he wrote, by reading what his students wrote, he is now a friend. He is now someone I can talk to. And that is important. Not just, and by the way, I don't mean a particular philosopher, any person who wrote books of significance. It doesn't matter what country they're from. Knowledge does not know a country, does not know a religion, does not know a political party. Knowledge is global. And so I, as a student, should look constantly and consistently all over the world. And when I get them, I keep them, because they are my friends. They will help me in times when I cannot get help. I want to leave this idea, constantly have books and constantly read books. Yes, today we have the internet, we have mobile, everyone picks up this mobile, reads. Uncle Google helps you, answer every question you have. No, he doesn't. Google and or any of these search engines give you a small sliver. If you want to understand something, you need to get the person who wrote about a specific thing and read his or her book through. You will have a better understanding. And at the end of the day, without knowledge, we really have no power. Thank you very much.